CodeQL is a bug bounty program like no other is because you don't actually get paid for finding the bug. You get paid for writing the scanner query to detect a vulnerability. And it is very intimidating at first. But for some reason, I've always felt like it's something good for me and for my skill set. Recently, I finally invested more time into it and I wrote my first proper CodeQL query to detect RCE vulnerability via ZipSlip. In this video, I will explain the query to you. Enjoy! CodeQL has queries to detect many different kinds of vulnerabilities. But of course, no scanner is able to detect every single vulnerability. That's why GitHub, which is the owner of CodeQL, has GitHub Security Lab bug bounty program where they pay you for finding the query. So if you find a publicly known bug, a bug that has a CVE that's not detected by the scanner, you can add the query to the scanner to detect this bug, and GitHub will pay you for this. It can be a new bug, but it can also be old bug. It can be your bug, but it can be someone else's bug. It doesn't matter. What matters is that your query must make sense in general for other projects. You can't just write a query that's directed into detecting a single bug in a single application. Nobody's gonna pay for this. The query must be precise and must also detect this bug in other software. In my opinion, the hardest part of writing a CodeQL query is finding a bug that's not yet detected by CodeQL, but you can reliably detect it by looking at the source code. Because some bugs you just can't model. How do you model a business logic error? I don't think you can do it reliably, so it makes sense for all the software out there. And in this video, I will describe to you what the query does, but also in the last issue of BBR Premium, I described the behind the scenes of writing the query, how I found the bug to model, what bugs I wanted to model, but I couldn't for some reason, why I made certain decisions, things I did to maximize payout. All those things are described in the article. If you are a BBR Premium member, I will link this in the description down below. And if you're not, consider joining. The bug I decided to model was ZipSlip vulnerability in discourse, which can lead to an RCE. How does it work? Normally, when we download a zip file from the internet, we just double click it and opening and extracting the files are the same operation. But in the code, it looks a bit different. First, you open the file that's an archive. Then in the for loop, you access every single file from this archive. But before creating the file on the disk, you should verify if the path is secure. In this case, in the case of discourse, this validation wasn't done. Using this ZipSlip vulnerability, you can create a file that has a ..slash sequence in the file name. And then even though your file is inside the archive, it will be unpacked to a completely different location. So this is an arbitrary file write vulnerability, which you can often turn into RCE in various ways. To detect any bug like this, we need three things. The first thing is the sync, which is a dangerous function to which malicious input should never go. And if it goes to this function, it means there's a vulnerability. Then we also need the source, which is a place where the server consumes our potentially malicious input so we can send some payloads. Finally, we also need the flow from the source to the sink because the source itself or the sink itself are not dangerous at all. And this is exactly how we'll write the CodeQL query. Let's start with the sync. You may think that the sync is the unpacking of the file, but it's not the case. The other way to think about the sync is the last place in the source code where I can look at it and say, okay, if my input gets to here, then I have the vulnerability and it doesn't matter what happens later. It is much more connected with the impact of the bug. In this case, the impact is arbitrary file write, so our sync will be file creation call. As you see, code review is a fundamental skill if you want to think about writing CodeQL queries, because first you have to understand where the bug happens in the code. To be more precise, the sync is not actually a function or a line. The sync is the path argument of the file creation call. So in this case, it's the first argument. You may ask, how about file contents? Do we somehow verify this as well? The answer is we don't. We care about the file path, and we assume that if we control the file path, we probably also control the file contents. And even if we don't control file contents, if we can write a file to an arbitrary location, even if the content is empty or whatever, we can probably at least overwrite some files, leading to another vulnerability, leading to denial of service. So in this case, we only care about the file path. And this is the very simple definition of the sync in my query, because I didn't have to model it from scratch. I used existing CodeQL models for this. We have the sync, so let's continue to model the source. The source should be the place where the server consumes the data from the attacker. In this case, however, it is just unpacking the file using one of the three libraries that I modeled for working with archives. The logic is actually exactly the same in all three of them. And you may ask, if we consider this as a source, how do we know that this file actually comes from the attacker and it's not a static file from the server? And you're actually right. This query is prone to false positives because I only excluded the case when it's called with a constant path, but it is still prone to situations where the server writes a file that's created by the admin or is just on the server. So it isn't perfect, but it's as good as I could write it. I actually also described the exact reason in the article. Without getting into much details, this is how it looks in the code. Okay, so we have the sync, we have the source. Now we need the third and final thing, which is the flow of data from the source to the sync. And here we mostly rely on CodeQL doing its job, because CodeQL is not based on some simple regexes or something like this. CodeQL knows, understands the code and knows how the data flows from one place to another. And mostly in the case of finding the flow from the source to the sync, we rely on CodeQL. But in this case, it wasn't finding the bug. It was very frustrating because I had the bug just in front of me and I had the query and it wasn't working on the real code base. I spent days here feeling like banging my head against the wall, confirming if my sources are correct, if my syncs are correct, and it didn't make sense to me of why doesn't it work. But of course, turned out it made a lot of sense, because the thing is that CodeQL understands the code, but it's not magic. It just, some operations are modeled in internal libraries that they allow the flow of the data from this place to this place. But in this case, I'm working on custom classes like tarReaderEntry, and the tarReaderEntry class is not modeled inside CodeQL, so CodeQL doesn't know, so it doesn't understand it. And in case of this vulnerability, in every single case, the path was accessed using either the name or full name function call. And CodeQL just didn't know what these functions are, so the flow was breaking in this step. But when we know where the flow breaks, it's usually quite easy to counteract this because we have another predicate called isAdditionalTimeStep, where I can define exactly this. I can define the place where CodeQL thinks the flow breaks, but it actually doesn't break. So I just defined that the call to a function called fullname or name does not break the flow. Although this isn't yet the end of the job, my query finally was finding the vulnerability in discourse in the real code base, which made me really happy and relieved after days of frustration and disappointment because I thought that maybe I just won't be able to model this. It's not yet the end of the job because it's important for my query to find the bug when it's there, but it's also important that my query doesn't find the bug when it's not there. Because if there is a sanitization before creating the file, we should also detect this and tell CodeQL that the flow should break there. We basically do the reverse of what we did previously. Previously, the flow was breaking and we had to tell CodeQL that this operation does not break the flow. In this case, the CodeQL has the full flow and we have to tell it that this operation is probably sanitizing the file path, so the flow should break there. I used the existing definition of sanitizer from the past traversals query, but it wasn't enough to find the way the bug was fixed in discourse. So I also created another definition of sanitizer that matched how the bug was fixed in discourse. The only problem is it doesn't work at all. It would detect this fix if it was inline check, but it doesn't detect it when it's a separate function call. And to be honest, to this day, I don't know why this happens. And if you know, just hit me a message because I'm really, really curious. But despite this, GitHub Security Lab awarded me $5,500 for this query, which made me really, really happy because it is my highest bounty. If you want to improve in CodeQL, maybe for getting bug bounty from GitHub Security Lab, but personally, I also start using it as a semi-automatic code review tool. If you're interested in CodeQL, I honestly recommend you to check out BBR Premium. I write things that I would have liked to hear before because I just know how overwhelming CodeQL is and how underwhelming is the amount of articles out there. And if you want to improve your code review skills first, check out this video about my exercise in Golang. For now, thank you so much for watching and goodbye.